welcome to what we've called the Fundamental Drum Workshop. This workshop is going to be addressing some pretty basic stuff, which is why we call it the Fundamental Workshop. No polyrhythms, no metric modulation, no double bass, no playing over the bar, none of that stuff. A lot of things that I have noticed a lot of drummers, young drummers especially, miss or just neglect, you know, addressing or trying to work on. All of this is stuff that is absolutely necessary for a drummer to, you know, be a drummer, yeah? You can get caught up in, you know, playing with speed and, you know, just get caught up in technique, and because drummers, essentially, we're always counting. You can get hung up with that, you can get, you know, just so hung up with the whole counting thing, and, you know, like I said, odd meters and all that stuff. And somewhere along the line, it's possible that you lose the music. Yeah, because you're somehow hung up with all these other concepts. First things first, I'd just like to talk about setup, you know, selecting drums and tuning them and setting them up right so that you can sit down and play them comfortably. Yeah. This, as you see, is a Mapex 5-piece VX jazz kit. Now, this is the kit I use. This is the kit I use on stage in the studio. And the reason I've chosen it is because size, you know, going by the sizes, this is what feels right to me. If the drums don't feel right, if the sizes are not right, you will never play them right. Okay? The sizes I'm using, going by my height and size, the bass drum is 20, which I find very standard. Okay? A 20-inch bass drum will work in most situations. You can play a jazz gig, you can play a funk gig, you can play a rock gig, it will cut it. Okay? Toms, 10, 12, 14. You get very standard. If I just give them a whack, you'll find they've got a fair amount of tone and like pitch. At the same time, they're powerful enough to cut through, so. I tend to find that unless you go really high up in quality, every drum manufacturer obviously has ranges. Unless you go really high up, the larger the toms, they don't really have very definite pitches. You'll mostly find 13-inch toms, 14-inch toms, always boomy and always kind of, you know, lacking definition. This kind of definition that you have, which is very clear, usually lacks in at least, you know, the lower ranges. So, now the reason I say this, I just want to explain now what I've said. So when I sit, and I'm sitting comfortably with my, you know, with my thighs pretty much at right angles to the floor, yeah, not too high, not too low. And when I sit, the drum should be placed in such a way, you should be able to place them in such a way that naturally where your hand, you know, wants to hit, I mean, where it falls is where the drum should be. It shouldn't be the case where you set up a kit and you've got like, 14 by 14 toms and it's up here and you've got a 24-inch bass drum and you are struggling to do this. I know it looks very cool, and in the 80s, especially 80s and 70s, 80s and 90s, it was all visual. So they had big kits, they had huge toms, the drummers were playing like up here, cymbals were, you know, further away, so everything was like big, movements were big. That was great visually, but, you know, not really prescribed in terms of ergonomics or in terms of, you know, kind of safe drumming. You will end up with some problems if you're always in unnatural positions. Yeah. So I'll just demonstrate what I, you know, just said. So now if I, even if I close my eyes, and if I want to just hit the snare drum, naturally my hand falls here, okay? My arms are relaxed. My shoulders aren't out, they aren't, you know, kind of forced in, they're not held high, anything. It's just absolutely, this is my hands loose, and if I kind of pick them up, just naturally, this is where my hands are, and if I bring it down to hit something, this is where it is, right? Same thing with my toms. If I close my eyes and I just do, you know, this is where my hands come down. I don't want them up here. I don't want them, you know, too far out. It's okay, so everything within reach. Yeah. So that's often neglected, but it's a very important consideration that when you're going out to buy your kit, your first kit or any kit for that matter, it's something that you have to, you know, not sit at a kit in the shop when you're buying it. Make sure that, you know, the sizes are right for you. And of course, having said that, it depends on what music you're going to be, you know, playing mainly or all the time. If you're obviously playing in a metal, you know, rock, a thrash band, you will need deeper toms. You will need to an extent. But again, you have to find that balance where you're comfortable and where the kit sounds right for the kind of music. Yeah. What are the elements of music? So the way I see it, and the way it is, I guess, is music has, you know, a couple of main elements. The two most important being sound or pitch and time. Okay, so when you listen to any music, when you play any music, you're playing pitches or sounds, and you're playing them in a certain time frame. You're using certain time values, you know, single notes, you're using many notes, you're using long notes in a certain time frame, and of course you're hitting stuff or you're playing stuff to, you know, create pitches. That's one aspect. That's time and pitch. Of course, then the sonic quality or the sound quality or the timbre of what you're playing. Obviously, you know, if I just keep playing, it's not going to make any sense. I need, you know, to fit the music, I need definite sounds. So if I'm playing like a basic groove, playing a group like that, and I had the need to play that one, you know, tom there, that's because I was looking for that sound, right? So if I hit a cymbal instead there, it wouldn't sound right, you know? So just the whole sonic quality of what's happening musically, that's important. And the third thing, of course, or rather the fourth thing, of course, is the relevance. It's very important with music, with, you know, most art forms, that it's essentially, well, it has to be relevant to your audience, or, you know, your, if it's, you know, paintings, your, the person who's viewing it or the audience who's listening to it. As the name suggests, is something basic, obviously. They're the basic building blocks of all drumming. And what they are is a series of sticking and stroke combinations, which literally make up everything that you hear. All drumming that you hear is based on rudiments and in some form or the other. Now, as of now, we have 40 rudiments that have been established by the PAS, which is the Percussive Art Society. It's growing. There are a lot of hybrid rudiments that broadly speaking, rudiments can be divided into four categories. You have the roll rudiments, roll as in R-O-L-L. You have the diddle, I know it sounds funny, D-I-D-D-L-E rudiments. You have the flam rudiments, and you have the drag rudiments. Now, each of these groups have a certain number of, you know, rudiments that are various combinations in there. So I'm just going to play one of each of the main rudiments. So you have the single stroke, which is the first of your roll rudiments, which is nothing more than just playing your right hand, following it with your left hand, one stroke each, okay? So this is how it goes. Okay, so that's your single stroke rudiment. You have, as he played, the paradiddle, which is right, left, right, left, as you know. So we just do that now. Okay, so that's the paradiddle. Next, we have the flam, which is a little tricky, but if you research it a bit, it's fairly simple. It's kind of like a flammed note, so it's two notes played in quick succession. You have the main note, which falls on the beat, and you have a small note that just precedes it. So this is how it sounds. Yeah? What's important here, I think I'll just move the cymbal for a bit. Alright, so what's important here is that it's not two separate strokes. The minute you play two separate strokes, it actually becomes like a single stroke thing. So if you're playing one stroke soft and the next one louder, it still doesn't qualify as a flam. So you cannot do... or... Alright? In a flam, both your hands have to move together because it's one hit, okay? The only difference is that your main stroke, the hand which is your main stroke, actually starts from a higher point. This one stays low. So if I'm flamming with my left and my main stroke is my right, I'll keep my left hand down and together. Yeah? You've probably, a lot of rock drummers have heard. Yeah? These are flams, okay? Okay? And the last one, the last group, is the drag, which is actually two, you know, light notes preceding your main hit. So it sounds like this. See, these are rudiments, but used effectively around the kit, they sound good. And essentially, of course, they will help you with your drumming because, as I said, all drumming is based on these.